So on the previous slides, we had these two relations S and T, and we took in this example calculations of the query results specific probabilities for the existence of a tuple or not. And what we do now is a slight change. We take our relations and we augmenting these relations with one additional column that we call E. E stands for expression. And inside these entries for this column, we are writing down tuple variables that are interpreted as random variables to indicate if a tuple is present or not. What we do now, we just have our normal table, S and T, and we just create one more column that we call E. And when we are doing a join now, in this case, according to B and C, so we're joining the B column with the C column, as we also did earlier. What we do then is to update this E column, indicating that in order to have this tuple in the result, well, this tuple S1 has to be there and the tuple T1 has to be there. That means this has to be there and this has to be there. So both have to be there. And in order to have N at the result, well, we have to have S1 and T1 in our probabilistic database being present. So we basically keep on updating when we're doing joins or other ways to evaluate the query. We are keeping track about this expression by logical equations. So now what's happening now, if you take this example join result, so we joined S and T by B and C, and we're applying a projection on the D attribute. That means in the end, we want to have this one. This was the first example we had, remember, where we had P, the result tuple. So now what we do, well, we are taking these two expressions here, S1 and T1, and also S2 and T1, and combine these to indicate when there will be P being a result tuple. Well, and when will P a result tuple? Well, P will be a result tuple if this tuple is there or this tuple is there. Yeah, if both tuples is there, it's fine as well. That means we take these equations and we combine them using a logical OR. And now we have for our result tuple P an equation that describes when P will be in the result. What we do not have yet are the probabilities. Now we have a way to construct these equations based on the basic variables attached to these individual tuples and rules, which we will define next, how to work with this expression when we apply an operator from relational algebra. So if we have a selection, so we have a table, and there are some attributes, and now here we have here our special column E, and we have a selection over this relation. Basically, how do we modify these expressions or these equations in the column E? Well, we just take them if the predicate applied to our tuple is true. So here's our selection predicate C. In all other cases, anyway, the tuple will be dismissed from the result because it does not qualify the predicate. So now it's getting a bit more complicated when we're talking about a projection. What do we do in case of a projection? Well, we take these individual equations here we have. And here in this case, we are assuming we are projecting on A. Let's say we have B as well here. So we are projecting on A column. And this means we take these expressions that we find in the E column here. and we concatenate them, or we combine them using a logical OR. And we do this for the same or the identical values inside the A column. So this means, for instance, we have here, let's say 1, 1, 2, 2, 2. So we take for these groups, here we have the group with ones and here we have the groups with twos. Within each group, we take all of these equations and we concatenate them or we combine them using a logical OR. We do this for the one values here and for the two values here. Why? Because we have set semantics. And in order to be for an A value to be there, there's to be at least one of these values here. And this means in our notation here that we have here this T corresponds, for instance, to the one tuple in this example. And here we take the OR over all expressions for tuples T prime, where T, so the one, comes from T prime by projecting on A, right? So if you have here B values of, let's say, 7 and 8, then this would mean here we have the logical OR over the expression for the tuple 1, 7 and the expression for 1, 8, because if you're taking 1, 7, so if you make a tuple out of this using parentheses, and they're projecting on the A, then we take, of course, these ones. So E of 1 will be then the concatenation or the combination using logical OR of these two equations, right? Just reconsider what the projection is doing and consider that's very important here that we're talking about set semantics. Now for a join, which is basically a join, we know it's only syntactic sugar. It's basically only a cross product followed by a selection. So we define here only what we do for cross products. For cross products, we take the logical AND for the left input and the right input tuple. Why? Well, if you have two relations, S and T, and you have a tuple here, let's say, and a tuple here, and then you want to know what is the expression. Let's say this tuple is called T and this is called T prime, and you want to know the expression of the concatenation of tuple T and T prime, which is what the cross product is doing. Cross product takes these two and combines them, right? And what is the expression? Well, it's just the expression that this tuple here is there and the expression that this tuple here is there, which is just this expression here. So this is kind of not obvious maybe, but hopefully intuitive to see what's going on here. But still, we don't have any probabilities now. We only have these equations. And how do we come from these equations to the probabilities? Well, the idea behind these equations is that they're indicating if a tuple is there or not. For instance, we have an equation here for the previous example, which says that this tuple, which is annotated by this equation, is present in a database in a possible world, in case the S1 random variable and T1 are true, or S2 and T1 are true, right? And how do we know how often and in which cases this happens? Well, we're looking at the well-known truth table, right? You all have seen one or the other course. Let's do this truth table for this expression. So there are three variables, S1, S2, and T1. And here, this E indicates when the expression is true. Now, the truth table enumerates all possible assignments of 0 and 1 to these basic equations, S1 and S2 and S, the basic random variables S1, S2, and T1. And we see we have only this assignment and this assignment, which is producing a 1 soll the equation to be true. Now, what are the probabilities of these individual assignments? Well, for this, we have to now assume that we know the probabilities for S1 to be 1 and S2 to be 1 and T1 to be 1. And then we can compute the probability of the assignment 0, 1, 1, which would be the first one here, which is, because of the 0, we take 1 minus probability of S1 times probability of S2 times probability of T1, which is 0.06. And we do this for all of these assignments that produce a 1. And then we sum up and have 0.54. This is also what we got in our brute force possible world enumeration. And in fact, it's not really different what we did here, because the truth table is exactly this possible world enumeration. And when we are looking here for the ones in the E column, this is exactly looking for those possible worlds where our result tuple is included. So we get naturally the same we got in the other way to compute this. There's only one problem with this way. It's too expensive. So in this slide, very briefly, I want to mention the complexity of this form of Curie evaluation. So if you have a Boolean equation, this is what we had before, this equation assigned to the individual tuples, and we kept track about them during Curie evaluation with these rules we have defined. And these expressions can get quite large. In this example, this was already quite large, even though the database was very small. And here we have in this assumption, a Boolean equation with n variables. So there are between 0 and 2 to the n assignments that fulfill the equations. For some queries, it can be computed how many of these fulfill in p time complexity class. For others, this is sharp p complete. And if you don't know what sharp p complete means, it's not a problem. But you all know what NP means, NP completeness, right? Now, the class sharp p is the class of counting problems. And if we talk about NP class, we talk about decision problems. And in sharp p, we talk about counting problems. For instance, in NP, we know the well-known example for the satisfiability problem set. And we are asking, is there an assignment that exists to fulfill the equation? Whereas in the corresponding problem in sharp p, we would ask for how many assignments fulfill the equation. This is known to be a sharp sat, in contrast to sat. Now, this problem here is certainly more complicated, because we don't only need to know that there is one fulfillment, but we need to know how many. And this means that the problem from sharp p is at least as complicated or difficult to compute as the corresponding decision problem from NP. So this is like not good, right? In particular, since there's a theorem from Leslie Valiant from 1979, which says that sharp sat is sharp p complete. Oh, this is a problem. It cannot be handled efficiently. So we have to come up with a different way to compute these probabilities for our possible tuple semantic.